Right, so hello and welcome back to Books and Things and welcome to another video. And today I'm going to be telling you about all my thoughts about David Copperfield by Charles Dickens. So David Copperfield was the October and November pick for the Mega Dickens Readalong. If you want to find out more about the Mega Dickens Readalong, I'll leave some links down below. But basically, the Mega Dickens Readalong is a two-year-long readalong where we're reading all of the works of Charles Dickens in publication order. We're a bit over halfway through now, and it's been really, really fun so far. So what I'm going to do today is talk about David Copperfield and my reflections on reading it this time, which was, I think, my fifth time reading it. The first bit of this video is going to be spoiler-free, and then I'll get into spoilers later, and I will warn you before that happens. So before I do anything else, let me tell you a little bit about what David Copperfield is about. David Copperfield is about the life of David Copperfield. We start with his birth and we go through to his kind of late 20s, I think, and it's basically David's coming of age story. We follow his childhood, his education, his courtships, his career, his relationship with his family members, with his friends, with everyone around him, and all the different people he meets along the way. I didn't read this physical copy. I listened to the audiobook narrated by Richard Armitage, which was really, really fantastic. Richard Armitage is a wonderful narrator. I've listened to this audiobook of David Copperfield before, and I think it is really, really good. Like, I think it is just a fantastic audiobook. The character voices are very good, and also the main problem I have with David Copperfield, which I will get onto later, or like the main thing I struggle with in it, is sort of softened or resolved by the way Richard Armitage narrates it. Like, I think he does what Dickens was intending with something that I slightly struggle with, maybe. So I'll talk a bit more about that later when we get onto spoilers. But I do feel like the audiobook deserves lots of credit for just doing David Copperfield very, very well. So I'll start off with my general thoughts about David Copperfield. I have written in my notes that this was the fifth time I've read it, but I feel like actually it might have been the fourth, but I'm not sure. Either way, I have read David Copperfield a few times before, and it's a Dickens book that I really, really love, but one that kind of goes up and down in my estimation. I feel like the last time I did a Dickens ranking, I feel like I put it in at number five after my top four, which kind of generally remain as my top four. But sometimes I feel like it actually belongs more like number seven. Like, sometimes I feel like it's slightly further down the list. Once we finish the Mega Dickens Readalong, I am going to do like a re-ranking of Dickens's books, and I feel like David Copperfield might go down a little bit, and I feel like Barnaby Rudge is gonna like shoot up quite a lot, so we'll see. I'll do that, you know, like next October or whenever the Readalong ends. It's quite a way to go yet, but I feel like it's a really fantastic work of literature, like really, really wonderfully written with fantastic characters, but I also agree with what a lot of people have been saying on Discord over the last few months as we've been reading it, in that it is a bit of a novel of two halves, and the first half, which is about David's childhood, is like just some of Dickens's absolute best work, and the way he looks at David's childhood and growing up, and his sort of childish perspective on things is just fantastic. But the second half of the book has a few things which maybe are a little bit less strong. And the other thing I was thinking about David Copperfield is that I don't actually love Dickens's first person novels the best. So Dickens has two novels that are written entirely in the first person, Great Expectations and David Copperfield, and I usually recommend these as really good places to start with Charles Dickens because I think they're a lot more accessible than his other books, so you just have one person to follow. There is also Bleak House, which is half in first person, but I think that's in a slightly different category because it has the third person omniscient narrator as well. But for me, Great Expectations and David Copperfield, just like, they're just not as fun as Dickens's books that are in the third person with like millions of characters. Obviously there are lots of characters in David Copperfield, but you just don't get to follow as many people in their many different worlds and many different adventures as you do in some of his other books. And so for me, I feel like Dickens's sprawling web of character books are always going to be the books I prefer. But I do think it has wonderful writing, wonderful characters, a really good look at growing up, like fantastic depictions of childhood. And it also has Tommy Traddles in, who is my favourite. As I've mentioned before, I do find that in a lot of Dickens books, my favourite character is like the sidekick of the main character. And Tommy Traddles is a friend of David Copperfield's, who I just adore in every way and who I think is wonderful. But we're going to talk about Tommy Traddles plenty later. So another thing I have been doing in all of these reflections videos is kind of thinking about Charles Dickens's books in chronology. And it's been really interesting to think about David Copperfield in chronology because it's much harder to compare this to his previous books because this is his first novel that is written entirely in first person, which makes it like a very, very, very different book to what has come before. I think the plotting is strong. I think the characterization is strong, but it is also like quite a different kind of novel. It spans a long period of time and is really, really focused on David in a way that like his previous books just weren't. They didn't have that same kind of focus. Like really, this is a book about David, his journeys, his memories, his personality. And yes, we do see quite a lot of the people who orbit him and it is a bit about them, but it's really a novel about one person in a way that like Dickens's previous books just weren't. You know, like Barnaby Rudge is a book about violence and prejudice. Martin Chuzzlewit is a book about selfishness. Dombey and Son is a book about money and gender. And David Copperfield is a book about David Copperfield. Like it's slightly hard to compare it to Dickens's earlier books. In a way, to me, Bleak House, which is the next book after David Copperfield, feels more like a natural successor to Dombey and Son than David Copperfield does, which, you know, kind of spoils a lot of my chronology thoughts. In fact, David Copperfield spoils a lot of my chronology thoughts about gender and Dickens as well. So I did my dissertation at university on how the presentation of gender changes over time in Charles Dickens's books, which was a really, really fun dissertation topic. I really, really loved it. And I looked at 7 out of 14 of Dickens's novels. I would have liked to look at them all, but my tutor was quite dubious about the fact I was looking at 7 books to begin with. He said that was far too grand a scope. And when I did produce the first draft of my dissertation, it was double the length it was supposed to be. But anyway, that's fine. I did 7 out of Dickens's 14 completed novels. I did not do David Copperfield. And it's probably just as well because it really would have ruined like a lot of my arguments in that I feel like Dombey and Son is such a turning point in terms of the way Dickens looks at gender. And then I feel like David Copperfield doesn't like progress some of the great things that are sort of beginning to be explored in Dombey and Son. Although in some ways it does, I don't know. I feel like in general, Dombey and Son is a much more like feminist novel than David Copperfield. But I also feel like there are some things that Dickens is trying to do in David Copperfield that aren't very effective, but he is trying to do things that are of interest. So I don't know. One thing I did want to talk about in terms of chronology is the writing style of David Copperfield and particularly Dickens's use of tense. Obviously, David Copperfield is in the first person, which is quite different from his previous books. But one thing Dickens kind of started in Dombey and Son and that we see kind of develop later is his use of the present tense. So Dickens kind of experiments with using the present tense a little bit in Dombey and Son for certain scenes. And then again, he uses it quite a lot in David Copperfield for certain scenes. And then we get to Bleak House, which we're reading this month and next month, which is like half written entirely in the present tense. And it's really interesting to see how Dickens kind of like increases his experimentation with the present tense and how he uses it in David Copperfield. The bits that Dickens uses the present tense for tend to be bits where David, like in the present day, writing about the past, where like his memories are so vivid that he almost becomes like immersed in it, like he's seeing it before him, and then he describes it in the present tense. And one thing I find quite interesting is that for me, I always associate the present tense with like really being in the moment, but the places Dickens tends to use the present tense in David Copperfield are not for like in the moment scenes. They're for sort of like long retrospectives where we're passing a long period of time and like following David in all the little steps that he takes along that period of time, but in present tense, which is quite an unusual technique, but I really like it. I find it very immersive. So that's very interesting too, to see kind of how he continues to play with the present tense in David Copperfield and again later on in his career. We'll see that more as well. So let's talk a little bit about the plot of David Copperfield. In general, David Copperfield is a fairly episodical novel because it is this kind of buildings romance, this coming of age story. Lots of characters kind of dip in and out of the story. So in some ways, I feel like it has slightly more in common with Dickens's earlier books in terms of its plot structure. And it also means it's a bit hard to talk about it without spoilers. But I think really David Copperfield is at its heart a coming of age story. You know, it's a book about David growing up and learning things. And I feel like David's childhood is captured so well. Another thing I really like about it is the kind of way that characters appear in David's childhood and then turn up again in his adulthood. And those sort of like reprises almost of characters are just really fun. That's something I really, really enjoy in David Copperfield. I also think there are some wonderful kind of dramatic sequences in the novel, especially towards the end. There's some really, really powerful moments that are really effective. And I think that makes the plot of David Copperfield pretty strong. I also do think, as I've said, that it is a much easier to follow plot than a lot of other Dickens books, because we're just always following David in the first person in his head. David Copperfield is a really rich novel in terms of characters. My favourite character in the book is Tommy Traddles, who I just love. Tommy Traddles is both simultaneously so fun and so good-hearted, and I really enjoy that his hair is always sticking up and he can't ever get his hair to lie flat no matter how hard he tries. I really enjoy him drawing skeletons at school as an expression of his misery, and I just really enjoy Tommy Traddles as a whole. I also love Betsy Trotwood, who is a wonderful, wonderful character, a real sort of like a force of nature. I very much enjoy Betsy Trotwood chasing all the donkeys off her land. Apparently Betsy Trotwood was based on a real life figure who lived in Broadstairs. You can go and visit her house, which is now a museum to Dickens, which is great fun. I very much enjoy that. I also really love Mr. Micawber and his family. I feel like they're drawn really well, and Mr. Micawber's like great swings in mood are really, really well written. I love Peggotty and all of her family, Ham, Mr. Peggotty, Little Emily, Mrs. Gummidge. Like, I feel like that complicated family is so well drawn. I really love Mr. Barkus. A great soft spot in my heart for Mr. Barkus. Mr. Murdstone is drawn really well. Uriah Heep is drawn really well. Steerforth is drawn really well. Now, I do have some problems with Agnes, and I do have some problems with Dora, but, you know, we're going to talk about them later. There's also David himself, who I haven't really spoken about yet, who I kind of think is a really well-developed character, in that you get to see in his head a lot. You get to see his love of stories. You get to see his kind of searching for the things that are important to him, and you get such a good sense of his like youth in places where he doesn't really understand. Like, I feel like the sort of coming of age story is done so well, and that we see an older David looking back on his younger self and knowing that he now knows better about things, and that is kind of fun. I do feel like David Copperfield is not the most exciting character in David Copperfield, but I feel that to a much less strong extent than I did about a book like Nicholas Nickleby, where Nicholas Nickleby, in my opinion, is a very boring character, whereas David Copperfield, I think, is a much more interesting character. I just think there are other characters in the book that kind of steal the limelight a bit for me. One thing that I do think is really fun to think about in terms of characterization in David Copperfield is that we have this great first line to David Copperfield: "Whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life, or whether that station will be held by anybody else, these pages must show." And I think this is such a great first line for many reasons. One, because it's just a great first line, but also because David Copperfield kind of isn't the hero of his own life. I'll talk about this a lot more in the spoilery section, but I feel like there are a lot of other characters who could be considered the hero of David Copperfield's life. Sometimes these are characters who David Copperfield kind of idolises himself, such as Steerforth when he's younger, and sometimes these are characters who kind of occupy a heroic space in some way. People like Tommy Traddles, Mr. Peggotty, Ham Peggotty, Mr. Dick, Betsy Trotwood, and many more. I'm going to talk about this a lot more later on in the video, but I thought I would mention it in the spoiler-free section too, because I do think it's a really like interesting question to think about in terms of David Copperfield. Kind of leading on from that question, I want to talk a bit about the themes of David Copperfield, because I feel like one of the main themes of the book is like David's search for identity, search for a home, search for a place to belong. You know, this book is called David Copperfield, or in full, The Personal History, Adventures, Experience and Observation of David Copperfield the Younger at Blunderstone Rookery. What a title. And one thing that I find really fun in David Copperfield is that David Copperfield has a lot of different names across the course of the book. David Copperfield, over the course of the book, is called David, Davy, Master Davy, Master Davy Boy, Trotwood, Trot, Mr. Copperfield, Master Copperfield, Daisy, Dodie, My Bad Boy, and I think possibly there are some more I've missed out as well. And I actually find it interesting, when I talk about David Copperfield as a book, I find it odd to call him David, because I want to call him Trot. Obviously, because you always see it from his first-person perspective, he isn't called something by the narrator, but he's called so many different things by so many different people around him that he kind of has all these different identities, and I think that's, like, really fun. I think that ties in so well to this kind of theme of him searching for an identity, coming of age, trying to work out who he is as a person, and his search for sort of a home and a place to belong. Something else you see in David Copperfield is that he moves through a lot of different homes, through a lot of different positions. He takes up space in different ways in a lot of different families, and in fact he moves through a lot of different social classes in the book as well. Another theme I think is quite important in David Copperfield, and indeed in quite a lot of Dickens's work, is the theme of kind of like mistreatment, injustice, bullying, and sort of power versus vulnerability. We see within the book, especially during David's childhood, a lot of people who have power taking advantage of those who don't have power. And I feel like there are lots of characters in the book who kind of have power and use that power to exploit other people, and often to exploit those who are at their most vulnerable. And I feel like the way this book looks at that, and especially looks at like David in his childhood and the vulnerabilities he has as a child, I feel like that is kind of explored really, really well and is something that is really interesting. Okay, from here on, I'm gonna have lots of spoilers. So if you haven't read David Copperfield, please head away and I will carry on with my discussion. There will be spoilers from now on. You have been warned. Before I move on from talking about mistreatment, I do feel like this theme is like really well explored through characters like Mr. Murdstone, through Mr. Creakle, and also through Uriah Heep later, but also through characters like Jack Maldon and the Old Soldier in kind of smaller ways later, where we see these characters who are sort of like stronger in some ways take advantage of characters who are vulnerable in some ways. And this theme actually takes us quite nicely onto talking about gender and marriage. And talking a lot more about Dora and Agnes, because I have many things to say about Dora and Agnes. But marriage is a really key theme throughout David Copperfield, and kind of what marriage is and what marriage ought to be is quite a key theme. And actually returning to this idea of sort of power versus vulnerability, the problem of kind of having a lack of power within marriage is definitely an important theme within the novel. Within the book, we have various wives who are mistreated by their husbands. We have Betsy Trotwood, who has been mistreated by her husband. We have Clara Copperfield and Mr. Murdstone. And we also have Mr. Murdstone's second wife, who we know has been badly treated by him. And we also, to a certain extent, have David Copperfield and Dora, because when he marries Dora, who is not well suited to him in lots of ways, he tries to form her mind in a way that is not as cruel as the way Mr. Murdstone tries to change David's mother when he's a child, but definitely has a similar quality to it. I think that's very, very intentional, which definitely ties into this theme of sort of men having too much power and exploiting the power they have over their wives within the social order of this period, which is why Betsy Trotwood, despite being a very different kind of woman to Dora, is always very sympathetic to Dora and always tells David to accept Dora completely as she is, because she knows, having been married and finding herself in a position where she lacked power, she knows the power David has over Dora, and she firmly believes he should never use it to his advantage. We also see the theme of kind of what marriage should versus what it shouldn't be in various other couples. We have Dr. and Mrs. Strong, we have Mr. and Mrs. McCorver, we have Peggotty and Barkis, and we have this idea that kind of comes up through Dr. Strong and Annie of different kinds of love. Annie talks about having a fancy for Jack Maldon in her youth, and this being the first mistaken impulse of an undisciplined heart, whereas she says that her love for her husband was founded on a rock. And so we see this kind of idea of different kinds of love, and obviously David's love for Dora and David's love for Agnes also kind of divides into those two things. His first love for Dora is the mistaken impulse of an undisciplined heart, and his love for Agnes is founded on a rock. So let's talk about Dora, because Dora is in many ways the problem of David Copperfield. Like, we have been talking a lot about Dora over on the Discord server, and I know a lot of people struggled with the second half of David Copperfield because of Dora. The depiction of Dora, David's first wife, involved a lot of infantilization and could feel both kind of generally patronizing, but also like a bit icky, because he is married to her and in love with her, but also at times talks about her like she is a child. So my reading of Dora has always been that she is there in part as a form of social criticism. I think Dora is there to criticize people marrying too young when they shouldn't, to criticize people marrying people they don't know very well, to criticize men valuing beauty and nothing else in women, or valuing beauty over anything else in women. And I think Dora is also there to criticize the lack of proper education for women, the lack of useful education for women. So I feel like Dora is there to try and do lots of social critique things, but I also feel like it slightly fails. My reading of Dora as a character has always been that she is meant to be very young, very inexperienced, and that she has been spoiled by her father and brought up for and educated for a very, very different kind of life than the one she ends up leading with David. She has been brought up by her father, basically expecting for her to make a good match to someone very wealthy, to live in a house with lots of servants, where she doesn't have to think about housework and housekeeping, where she doesn't have to manage accounts, where she doesn't have to think about these things. She has been brought up to live the life of an upper class lady. And when she has to live the life of a middle class lady, she doesn't know what to do. Of course she can't do the accounts. Of course she can't cook. She's never been taught to cook. She's never been taught maths. What she has been taught is how to play the guitar, how to paint, and how to do her hair and curl paper so that she looks pretty. These are the skills that Dora has been given for life. Of course she is not equipped. I think Dora's inability to, like, manage a house is meant to be a criticism of, like, the education for upper-class women. I think that is what it is meant to be, but also I don't know how effective it is at that. And I do also think the book is critical of people marrying too young. Dora and David are meant to be very, very young when they marry. When they get married, David is, I think, just turned 21, and Dora is meant to be younger than him. So I think Dora is probably only about 19 or 20 when they get married. It's hard to tell. There's a scene at Dora's birthday where David meets her for the second time, and he describes Julia Mills, her friend, as comparatively stricken in years, almost 20, I should say, which makes me think that this birthday party of Dora's is probably meant to be her 18th birthday, but it might be her 17th birthday. I think David is 19 at this point. And I think when they get married, David is meant to be 21 and Dora is a few years younger than him. And I have always thought the kind of point of their marriage story is that they are both just kids. Like, they're really too young to get married. I think it's really interesting that one of the marriages set up as, like, the great marriage of the novel, in a way, like the marriage David uses as his example of a good marriage, is the marriage between Annie and Dr. Strong, where there is a really big age gap. Obviously, the other marriage set up as a good marriage in the book is David and Agnes, who are, like, more or less the same age. But the suggestion that, like, at least one of you needs to know what you're doing in life before you get married, I think is the suggestion that is present in the marriage between Dr. Strong and Annie, because Annie is quite young when they get married. But I think the idea is that both David and Dora are so young that they just don't know what they're doing. And in a way, I think there's a lot of comparisons drawn between Dora and David's mother, who, you know, in the very first scene of the book, when Betsy Trotwood arrives to see her before she gives birth, she says, "You're just a baby. You know, you're far too young to be having a child, to be married. What are you doing?" And this idea of, like, women marrying far too young because they are prized only for their beauty and the problems that causes for them, I think is a social criticism issue that Dickens is trying to explore. But does he do it very well? I don't know. The presentation of Dora is quite complicated because on the one hand, it does feel very patronising, and it is quite infantilising. You know, Dora asks David to think of her as his child wife, which is a bit, like, icky, isn't it? However, I do think it is worth saying that although David is quite infantilising to Dora, and so are a lot of other characters around them, Dora is also quite infantilising to David. Like, she calls him Dodie rather than David, and she calls him, like, my bad boy, my old boy. She calls him boy a lot of the time. And there's a bit later where Dora says, you know, maybe it would have been better if we'd have loved each other as a girl and a boy rather than getting married. And actually, it does feel like in a lot of their married life, they are kind of play-acting married because they're too young, you know, in years, but also emotionally, to really know what they're doing. Someone on the Discord server was saying that they felt like Dora was written about with such tenderness and compassion that kind of excused the sometimes patronising feel to it. And I do think that is true. And I actually think especially the Richard Armitage audiobook is done really, really well and narrated and acted really well in the chapters about Dora, especially about Dora's death. And I feel like you get such a sense in the novel, but also in that audiobook, because it's so well acted, of David's love for and sadness for Dora, that I feel like that kind of does make it easier. And I do feel like the treatment of Dora I find easier in an audiobook than maybe I do when reading it physically. But I also do think that within David Copperfield as a text, you know, regardless of who's reading it, there is this kind of compassionate acknowledgement that different people have different capabilities and strengths, which I think you see in a character like Dora, who is unfailingly kind, but also can't really cope with a lot of things that life throws at her. But we also see in a character like Mr. Dick, his mind does not work like the minds of other people. But I think there is such, like, respect for and affection for that from David and from the other characters around him. One thing I do find really interesting in Dora's presentation is that Dora is actually very similar to a lot of Dickens's early heroines, in that she is, you know, beautiful and sweet and good-natured and a bit childish, and that is kind of most of her personality. Whereas Agnes is a lot more similar to Dickens' later heroines, especially I think Agnes has some things in common with Esther Summerson, who we'll meet in Bleak House, although Esther Summerson is a much more developed character. In a way, David Copperfield is almost like Dickens turning his back on the heroines of early Dickens and moving towards the heroines of late Dickens. Like, I do really think there is meant to be social criticism in David's relationships with Dora and Agnes about Victorian men valuing beauty over everything else. Agnes is meant to be a lot more intelligent and a lot more capable than Dora. But I think the problem with what Dickens is trying to do in David Copperfield is that Agnes is a little bit nothingy, so it doesn't quite land. Like, I just don't actually feel that I know Agnes that well as a character. Like, I just feel like Agnes as a character remains a bit elusive. Like, we know that she is good and clever and selfless and a better judge of character than David, but what else do we really know about her? And one good point that some people made on the Discord server as well was that because we only see Agnes through David's first person perspective, which is quite like worship heavy, therefore all we know about Agnes is that she is an angel. Like, we don't get a real good sense of her as a person because David's attitude towards her, even before he's in love with her, is one of sort of like worship more than knowledge. So we sort of don't get to know her very well. Throughout the book, we do have lots of other really interesting female characters, and we have some stronger, tougher, positive female characters like Betsy Trotwood, like Peggotty, and some stronger negative female characters as well. People who misuse their strength, like Miss Murdstone, like Rosa Dartle. But Agnes and Dora, as the two main love interests, do kind of fall down a bit. I think another thing that a lot of people struggle with in the kind of like endgame love story between David and Agnes is that they do spend like a lot of time in the book referring to each other as brother and sister before they fall in love, which, you know, feels obviously like a little bit dodgy. And considering the other like marriage held up to be a great marriage in the book between Dr. Strong and Annie is also one where they had like a slight father-daughter relationship kind of thing before they got married, it's a bit incestuous, isn't it? I will say though, as this isn't the only Dickens book or the only Victorian book by any means where you find a sort of like pseudo brother-sister relationship developing into a romantic relationship, I do think it is worth saying that basically for the Victorians, like, the only legitimate relationships between men and women were familial or romantic. Like, a friendship between a single man and a single woman was just not really considered to be a normal thing, which means that basically the only way for couples in Victorian literature to be friends before they fall in love is for them to either be actually related by being cousins or for them to, like, adopt the forms of a familial relationship to make their friendship acceptable. So I do feel like it's worth saying that that kind of like brother-sister dynamic between Agnes and David is mostly a way of legitimizing their friendship. And it is also, I think, a way for Agnes to like try and cope with her long-term unrequited love for David, which we get a sense has been going on forever. And later it's a way for David to kind of cope with what he thinks is his unrequited love for Agnes. Next, I want to talk a little bit about the way David Copperfield looks at like the trope of the fallen woman. In general, I think the Steerforth and Emily plot is done quite well. Like, I think it's really interesting. I think Emily's an interesting character. And I think it's interesting that we get this plot in a Dickens book where we're seeing it all from David's perspective and he is one step removed. Like, we don't really know why Emily runs away with Steerforth. Is it because she falls in love with him? Maybe. But is it also because she wants to be a lady? Think of all the money that she sends home to her uncle. Does she actually run away with Steerforth because she thinks it's a way to help her family? Or is it mostly because she doesn't want to marry Ham, because Ham is someone who she actually does view as a brother, and she has almost like agreed to marry Ham out of gratitude to him and because she thinks it'll make her uncle happy, and actually maybe she just wants to do something different and she doesn't know how else to break off her engagement. I feel like there's a lot of complicated things at play there, and I also feel like the idea of the fallen woman is kind of interestingly criticised and looked at within David Copperfield. You know, within David Copperfield, Steerforth is viewed as a lot more to blame than Emily for the situation, which for the Victorian period is actually relatively progressive. And I always think of the bit when Ham talks to David later on and he says, Tain't that I forgive her, tain't that so much. 'Tis more that I beg of her to forgive me for having pressed my affections upon her. Odd times I think that if I hadn't had her promise for to marry me, sir, she was that trustful of me in a friendly way that she'd have told me what she was struggling with in her mind and would have counselled with me, and I might have saved her. Ham is very aware that there are a lot of people at fault that aren't Emily. And Ham is also very aware, I think, that one of the reasons why she has run away is maybe because she didn't really want to marry Ham. And I feel like Emily, as a kind of like fallen woman figure within Victorian literature, is really interesting in David Copperfield. Because it's not that she's redeemed so much as that she doesn't need redeeming. And actually, Emily's fate in David Copperfield is really, really interesting because, in general, there are lots of fallen woman figures in Victorian literature, many of whom are shown to be like good people, but they still mostly die. They still mostly die at the end. And Emily does not die at the end. She goes on to live a full life abroad with her beloved uncle in Australia, and they build a new life for themselves. And Martha, the other fallen woman figure within the book, marries. And it is actually quite a big deal within Victorian literature for a figure who is a fallen woman to get married at the end of the book. And she marries a man who knows about her past and doesn't care. And that's actually a really radical, rare fate for a character with Martha's backstory to be given in a Victorian novel. You know, within David Copperfield as a novel, Emily goes on to lead a full life in Australia with her uncle, and Steerforth, the man she ran away with, dies. And that is not what usually happens in Victorian literature. I feel like Emily's story in David Copperfield is done pretty well. And I feel like the social criticism Dickens is trying to do about the position of women and about the idea of the fallen woman in David Copperfield, I think works really well. So even if I struggle with Agnes and Dora, I do feel like some of the social criticism in David Copperfield to do with the position of women is actually working really well. The next thing I want to do is return to the question of whether or not David is the hero of his own life. And this in a way ties into gender and masculinity, because, you know, a lot of David Copperfield as a book is about David kind of finding a position for himself in the world, finding his place to belong, making a career for himself, getting married twice, and, you know, like trying to tick off the things that you are meant to tick off as a middle-class man in Victorian society. But I find it very interesting to think about the kind of big events that happen at the end of the novel and the role slash lack of role that David plays in them. So think about the taking down of Uriah Heep, because this is like the big climax of the novel in many ways. Uriah Heep is sort of the closest the novel has to a full villain, I would say. In the ending where Mr. Micawber and Tommy Traddles bring down Uriah Heep, Uriah Heep thinks David has orchestrated it all because he hates David Copperfield and he believes this is all David's doing. But none of it is David's doing. David has done nothing but turn up. The people who orchestrate the downfall of Uriah Heep are Mr. Micawber and Tommy Traddles. The person playing the hero's role in that scene is not David Copperfield, it's Tommy Traddles. And I really would argue that Tommy Traddles is the true hero of David Copperfield, because Tommy Traddles does everything right that David doesn't. Tommy Traddles picks a profession, works really hard at it, succeeds at the end of the book. He finds a woman who he really loves. They get engaged and they wait until they manage to marry, and their love really stands the test of time. One thing I find is really interesting is that Tommy Traddles is engaged to a young woman called Sophie, and he has met the whole family, including Sophie's many, many, many sisters. And one of the sisters is referred to as the beauty. And Tommy Traddles doesn't fall in love with the beauty. He falls in love with Sophie, who is like nice and sensible and well suited to him. Whereas I think we can all say for certainty that if David Copperfield had met that family before he met Dora, he would have fallen in love with the beauty, because that's the kind of person David Copperfield is. Even when they're at school, Tommy Traddles can see and is able to stand up to bullying much more effectively than David is. And at the end, he is the one who is able to bring down Uriah Heep. There's even that bit where David Copperfield and Tommy Traddles go to see Dora and her aunts, and the aunts mistake Tommy Traddles for David Copperfield. And I feel like that's such a fun moment, because actually it's very easy to mistake Tommy Traddles for David Copperfield, because Tommy Traddles is the real hero of this book. However, I know I'm slightly making a joke of this because I love Tommy Traddles and I think he is much better than David Copperfield, and I would much rather read a book about his life. However, I do think actually Dickens is very purposefully doing some clever things in David Copperfield, where he begins with that question and he repeatedly answers that there are so many other people in David's life who are more heroic than him. If you think about all of the other plot lines in David Copperfield and the resolutions to all of them, David is never the one playing an active role. He is a passive participant in the resolutions of most of the plot lines of the book. In The Tempest, Ham is the one who goes out to try and save the man on the boat who turns out to be Steerforth. David is watching from the shore. In The Discovery of Emily, it's Mr. Peggotty and Martha who do all the work. There's even this bit where David is literally waiting outside of the door while Rosa Dartle is being like awful to Emily, and he thinks to himself, I have to wait for Mr. Peggotty because it's not my place, you know, it's not his role in the story, he's just here. In patching things up between the Doctor and Annie, it's Mr. Dick who is the heroic figure, not David. Though he's troubled by the situation, he does nothing. David Copperfield isn't the one who brings down Littimer, that's Miss Moucher. David's aunt is a much more heroic figure than David. She's able to save him as a child. She keeps from them that Mr. Wickfield ruins her financially because she wants to protect Agnes. Agnes is a much more heroic figure than David. She remains silent for so long about her feelings for David as an act of sacrifice, whereas David cannot even really manage to stay silent about his feelings for a few months. Throughout, David Copperfield, we're presented with all of these figures who are so much more heroic than David Copperfield and who are more active agents in many ways in David Copperfield's life. David spends a lot of the book of David Copperfield making mistakes and being a passive character in other people's stories. And maybe that is kind of the point, after all, isn't it? And maybe that is what makes David the hero of his own life. It's his own lack of heroism. The fact that he is very human, very flawed, very real, and very normal, maybe that makes him the protagonist of his own life, even if he's not quite the hero. Okay, I think that's all I have to say. I feel like I've been filming for a very long time, but I have had fun. I always love talking about Dickens, and I have many thoughts about David Copperfield and even more thoughts about Tommy Traddles. Okay, I think that's all I wanted to say. David Copperfield is a great book and I have lots to say about it, as you may have been able to tell. I find it a really interesting one. I do love it a lot. I feel like it's not up there with my absolute favourite Dickens, but I do think it's a great book and I do think it's a really, really interesting one. So please let me know down in the comments, did you read David Copperfield over the last few months? What did you think about it? And that's all for now. Thanks so much for watching and I'll be back very soon with another bookish video.